Hey everybody, it's Tony Trombo. Today's show is brought to you by Audible.com. Now you can get a free audiobook. That is a free audiobook download and a 30-day free trial at audibletrial.com/Tony Trombo. They have over 150,000 titles to choose from for your iPhone, Android, Kindle, or MP3 player. That's audibletrial.com/Tony Trombo.
Hi, this is Candy Zappa. I'm Frank Zappa's little sister.
Hi, this is Bob Harris, former Frank Zappa band member.
Hi, folks. This is Robert Bobby Martin from Frank Zappa's band, 81 through 88.
Hi, grown-up boys and girls. I'm Sandro Liva, and I was the Italian of the group with the Grandmothers in the 90s.
Hi, this is Arthur Barrow, a.k.a. the Clone Meister for the Frank Zappa Band, as well as his bass player.
Hey, this is Lisa Popeil.
Hi, this is Susanna Harris, former vocalist for Frank Zappa.
This is Billy Hulping from Zappa Plays Zappa.
This is Ike Willis, and we're talking Zappa on Uncle Tony's station here. Please, everybody listen. I had a great time, and so will you.
Hi, boys and girls. This is Don Preston. You're listening to Talking Zappa, and you should all listen to this show because it's fantastic.
Yes, I always like that when Don says it's fantastic. How does Don know it's fantastic? He must listen to every show, or not. Hey, everybody, it's Talking Zappa with Tony Trombo, and that is me. And this is my new little adventure here, posting all my shows on YouTube. So they're safe and sound, and you can listen to them and find them easy. And I've been going through different platforms, and, you know, it's like I can't figure out where I want them to land, and YouTube is the place. It's the place to put things. Let's see. TonyTrombo.com. TonyTrombo. That is where you can find everything video-wise and books and, you know, stuff. And oh, God. I've done a lot of stuff. Today, boy, this is good. I got a hold of Robert Martin, or Bobby Martin, as I know him. But, you know, it's Robert Martin, which is cool. He actually talked to me at length, and a really fascinating guy. He does, now he's doing classes, I guess, on, you know, Frank's music and things like that. Really cool. So actually, I mean, if you get a chance to see him, well worth it. And this interview was very interesting to me, because I have always liked what he's done, and that's it. I ran out of steam. How's that? See, when I get talking, I can keep going, but then I just lose track. So let's get right to it. Here would be my interview from a little while ago with a keyboard player, a horn player, a vocalist. He does everything. He probably teaches dancing lessons, too. I don't know. Here it is, ladies and gentlemen, my interview with Robert Martin.
Hey, are you there?
I am here, Tony. There. How you doing?
Pretty good. Now, you're in Los Angeles, aren't you?
I am.
I'm over here.
It's a beautiful sunny day here.
Yeah, well, yeah, what's new? Yeah, I mean, you didn't have to say that. We all know. See, I moved from there like 17.
I know. The rest of the country's been having a rough time, huh?
We are. We're getting blasted, and I remember the good old days being there where it's all nice and that's all right. It'll be summer soon. And, of course, people can listen to this, you know, 20 years from now or whenever
there
the internet.
Go.
So it's February of 2014 when we're talking right now. So, you know, this is I did a little bit of research. And, of course, we all know you played with Frank. And that is kind of the idea of this show. But I've just made a list. I made a list, and the list got so long, I got tired of writing with people. My hand got tired. Paul McCartney, Michael McDonald, Stevie Nicks, Kenny Loggins, Prince, Michael Bolton. Holy cow, that's you've been around.
I've been around. Yeah, it's been quite a ride, and it ain't over yet. And I'm just loving every minute of it, and have been for many not years but decades.
Now, are you doing more keyboards or French horn, sax? What are you doing with most of those guys?
Well, in most of those situations, they would generally try to take advantage of everything I do. So, I did get to whip out all those instruments and sing along, and so that's been great too, because I can't say that I love anyone more than any other, and I wouldn't want to give any one of them up. That's why I kind of did not go into just the classical thing. I just couldn't put on the blinders and say, okay, I'm going to be a symphony French horn player for the rest of my life. There were too many other kinds of music I loved, and too many other things I loved, ways of expressing that I loved to do with saxophone and singing and keys and everything.
Well, that's great. I've heard that quite a few times. That seems to be a theme with everybody. If you try and single up and do one thing, you can starve to death. And so you got to branch out and do whatever you can for whoever you can.
Well, unless you're Steve Vai, you know.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. Yeah. Yeah, right. I don't see him playing the banjo very much. Not
no.
To think. I'd like to see him try, though. You know what? I'm going to talk to him one of these days. I'm going to say, when's the banjo coming up? When are you going to do magic on that like Steve Martin does, you know?
You know, I bet he'll do that when he gets like 70 or something. He'll probably put out a banjo album.
Sitting there on the front porch playing the banjo.
There you go.
Oh, boy.
Yeah.
Now, you're in a couple of, band from Utopia, where you guys do Frank songs all over the place.
Now that's a new thing, a new focus, and it's been really, really great. You're somebody that researches, I know, so I'm sure you know something of the history of the band. We were contacted by the promoters of the Jazz Open Festival in Stuttgart, summer of 94, 6 months after Frank died. And they asked us if we would, put together a band of alumni to honor Frank's life and music and do some shows over there. And we did, and it was amazing. It was it was a pretty emotional experience because his loss was very fresh. But we managed to handle that and just had such a great time doing it that we decided to keep doing it. And for the next few years, we did shows with various different lineups because different ones of us were available at different times. And Band from Utopia was a viable entity for a couple of years there, but then it all kind of just disappeared, just kind of petered out as we all went on to other things. But then the way it came back together again was 2 years ago in 2012. I was over performing at the Zappanali Festival in Germany, and a couple of guys from Norway, Erlend Sunden and Bjorn Herheim, who have become good friends, approached me about headlining a Zappa festival that they had planned for that fall of 2012. And I said, sure, that would be great fun. Let's do it. And I performed there and headlined that festival with a great band from Norway called Dead Dino Storage. And it went really well. So Erlend and Bjorn said, wow, this was great. Can we do this again? But please come back with a band of Zappa alumni. That would so rock if we could do that. So I said, yeah, great idea. So I started contacting the guys, and we basically put back together a band of alumni, basically reformed yet another iteration of Band from Utopia, and headlined the Zappa Union Festival in Oslo this past November. And everybody just had a ball, and so we're loving doing it. We did a tour, actually, following that for a couple of weeks throughout five countries in Europe in November. We're gearing up to do another one towards the end of March and beginning of April. I'm doing a couple of concerts in Holland in March the 22nd and 23rd, and then the rest of the band is going to come over and we're going to do a couple more weeks. So everybody's loving doing it. The fans are loving it. The response from all over the world has been amazing. We even had one guy come all the way from Japan to Oslo for the Zappa Union Festival that we just did in November. So it's been great. It's been really, really fun to do, enjoyable to do. And again, one of the aspects of playing with Frank that I always loved has come back into my life again, which is getting to play not just that great music, with Frank back in those days, but getting to play it with amazing musicians. I mean, these guys are just ridiculously brilliant, and it's just wonderful fun to be on stage doing this with them again.
Did you know before you got into Frank's band, were you a fan? Did you know a lot of that stuff, or was it?
I was very. I was very much aware of Frank, actually. I was a senior in high school in 66 when Freak Out came out. So right. I was aware of Frank right from the beginning, was really pretty blown away by that album. It was so different and fresh and new and innovative. And when he came to Philly the following year in 67, I went to see him at the Spectrum in Philadelphia. Mm-hmm. And it was a great show, an amazing show. And then 7 years later, I went to see him again at the Spectrum in Philly again, and that was, of course, that was in 74, which was the great band with George Duke and Nappy and Tom and Chester and Ruth, and that was a brilliant show, and I was, again, pretty flabbergasted by how far he had gone in the 7 years since I had seen him previously. And then 7 years after that, in 81, I joined the band. So
joined them, who was the drummer then when you joined?
It was Chad. Chad came in the same year as me, 81.
Okay, all right. I thought so, but
all the tours that I did with Frank, Chad was the drummer.
I see.
Yeah.
Now I had it's pretty funny. I've talked to Lisa Popiel, who got hired for like, you know, a week to do keyboard.
Right, I know. Like, I was there. Yeah.
He's like, yeah. Then I got replaced. You know, it was Bobby Martin. I'm like, Robert Martin. See, I want to say Bobby because I've known you as Bobby Martin for years.
That's okay. You know, my Facebook page, I have Robert Bobby Martin. Bobby,
okay, all right.
You know, so it's okay.
I tried to make her feel better. It's like, you know, it wasn't like me that replaced you that can play a halfway decent piano. You know, it was somebody that can really, really, really play. So, you know, it's not the end of the world, Lisa. It's just, you know, you know, you could have done a lot worse. You could have been like, here, get out, and Tony's going to replace you. And that would have been just humiliating, but, you know, it's okay.
Now, come on. Don't downgrade yourself like that.
Hey, my left hand sucks. My right hand's pretty good, but my left hand is always, it's, you know, that... I watch Tommy Mars. I watch you. It's like, damn, that left hand is just going to town. And I don't know. Maybe if I get a scale book and just sit there by the hour and just play scales, it might get a little better. But I started out on the, and you're not going to laugh at this, are you? The accordion.
Oh, no.
Good, you didn't
laugh. You have to go to jail. You have to go to jail.
So, and, you know, I'm a good Italian, and so I had to play the accordion. I don't know why, but now,
well, do you play the Godfather theme?
Oh yeah. Yeah. See, back in the when I started taking the accordion, it was, you know, it used to be a classical instrument. They used to play cool classical things, and then all of a sudden they started making like Billy Joel and Elton John and things for the accordion. It became a joke. And it really was a joke, because those are horrible to listen to on that instrument.
Well, you know, there were some pretty darn good players. There was a guy I remember, Art Van Dam, used to win the Downbeat Jazz Bowl all the time. And I used to watch Myron Florn on the Lawrence Welk show with my parents. I'm sure you're aware of
him. No, you're gone, yes. But there are, you know, there are instruments that are made for certain styles of music, and you just shouldn't make them cross over into other things.
Well, you know what? The accordion and its variations, you know, various kind of French squeeze box kind of items have really come back into vogue through the whole Cajun New Orleans thing. So, you know, it's become sort of cool and hip again.
Well, you got those, they're all MIDI accordions now where Rideco. You sound like any instrument you want. Just like I talked to Ed Mann,
right.
Like, yeah, I use the MIDI, the Mallet Cat, and it can be a banjo or, you know, or
there you go.
It can be anything. So... people are really opening up.
You could have a revival. You could join a Zydeco band and revive your accordion career.
I really should. All years of lessons, man, down the drain.
Yeah.
Unless I do it. You know, one thing that really stands out that you did, and when you did Whipping Post with Frank, that was one of the greatest renditions ever. How did, I mean, I know the drunk guy yelled it out, and I know the kind of the story
and
you guys played and all that. But how did you know that song? How did you get assigned to sing that
one? Oh, absolutely. Absolutely, I knew that song. I in fact, I met the Allmans in 71. I was down at the South Jersey Shore That was my first summer after leaving school, and I met this guy from Nashville that went to school, military school with Greg when he was like 14 or something. And so when they played at the Steel Pier in Atlantic City, I went to see him and hung out with him backstage and all that. But yeah, I was aware of them, and I knew that song, in that band, we used to do Allman Brothers. It was a kick-butt band that I had in 71. And we had a front man that did the song, and it always kind of frustrated me because I thought, oh, man, I would love to do this song. So then a couple years later, I was in a different band, and I did get to sing it. So I had known it for a long time. I had known it since the 70s. And when Frank... just out of the blue one day in rehearsals for the first tour, said, "Do you know Whipping Puss?" I said, "Whoa, do I know Whipping Puss? You bet." And he said, "Okay, great. Teach it to the band, have it ready for rehearsal tomorrow." So I did, and we did it, and it became the show closing encore. So it was just immense, immense fun for me. And it was kind of a different thing for Frank because he wasn't into covering other people's material too much.
But, right.
Yeah, it became kind of an iconic rendition, and it was just immense fun. My one complaint was that he always played it too darn fast.
Oh, really? Yeah. Right. Well, I mean, it's a cool song. Just it's got some, it's not just a straight four.
Right.
It's got some pretty cool time things happening there. I mean, it's just weird enough that it fits.
Yeah, it had the intro in 11 and then went to 12/8 for the rest of the song.
Now, as far as speaking of weird time things, how did you, were you real comfortable with all that crazy, tuplet things that you got thrown by Frank? Or some people, could handle it and some had to really fight to feel
well,
it.
Again, I had intensive classical training, so when I first went through the audition process and all that, I was able to sight read, these crazy complex things. That's something that it comes second nature to people more so than some people more so than others, but it was never really that much of a stretch for me. I remember when Brubeck came out with the Take Five record, and that was like, whoa, this is really cool. But when you look at it, the stuff Frank was doing was so far beyond that. It made Dave Brubeck's Time Out record look like kindergarten.
Right.
By
comparison,
when you look at the blazing fast 7 in Inca Roads, for instance, when George did the keyboard solos. Now we do that too. But we actually separate the keyboards up into trays between saxophone and guitar. We like to try and switch things up a little bit. And Ed takes the first solo in that song on mallet. So, we like to do things that are a little bit surprising, but very, very effective at the same time. So, yeah, the time thing, you kind of whatever you have to do to get comfortable with it. Different cultures throughout the world have sort of different approaches to not only time but pitch. There are microtonal scales that are common, and people grow up with them, and it's normal for a baby in Romania to hear 14 or 16 tones of the scale and odd time signatures.
Right.
It's just kind of whatever you grew up with, so it's not like humans aren't aren't capable of it. But if you're not comfortable with it, then you need to do whatever you have to do, like set up a loop in 11 and just get comfortable playing over it and shed with it on your own if that's what you need to do. But that was something that we had to do, and we also had to do not only odd time signatures like 7 and 5 and 11 and all that kind of stuff, but we had to learn to do tuplets accurately over another signature.
Right.
Like, for instance, at the end of Black Page,
There
are three bars in a row where it's 11 over a 4/4 measure, a series of 11 tuplets for three bars in a row. And Frank would just have us play that and cycle it over like a reggae groove and play like two bars of reggae and then do the 11s and then two bars of reggae and then do the 11s until it was comfortable and smooth and we felt it and it was natural. Repetition is the mother of skill, necessity is the mother of invention.
Yeah.
And repetition will get you there. So that's what we did as a group. And if you needed to do more on your own, then you take it upon yourself and be responsible and do it on your own, too.
I had heard that Frank would actually sometimes, maybe, I don't know if this is true or not, but he would write out things that appeared to be scales and would say, here, take this home and play this scale. And magically that scale would, or that group of notes became something that was a song he was working on. Did you ever,
right.
you ever get that where it's like you just thought, I'm just practicing this to practice it, but it actually became something?
Yes, that did happen. And in fact, he would sometimes write out on just on some music paper a tone row, an arbitrary tone row that he would create and say, okay, here are the notes that are allowed.
Right.
And we're going to improvise using these notes, using this this tone series. And he would also do things like that in terms of chords. Here's how you are going to structure this chord, and that's what we're going to improvise over. And, yeah, sometimes it did turn into something. That was one of the great things about working with Frank, too. I mean, things constantly changed and evolved and grew, and he was very much into spontaneity and creativity, and that was, rather than the exception, that was the rule, that was the norm. So that was great for your brain, great for your fingers, great for your psyche and everything to be in that kind of spontaneous creative atmosphere.
Now, I know that Lisa Popiel was saying that she had some passage and she asked Frank, you don't have any fingering on this. How did you play it? And Frank's just like, well, I just pounded it out with one finger. You figure out the fingering. That's your problem.
Right.
She said some of these things are impossible to play. It's like, well,
But, figure it out.
Yeah, figure it out.
Funny. That reminds me of a very funny story, and I heard an interview with Tommy Morris, and I remember distinctly going through this with Tommy in rehearsal. There's a passage in I think it's Jumbo Go Away, where it's just ridiculously impossible keyboard part. And Tommy was struggling with it. And Tommy's brilliant. I mean, he's got blazing technique, and this was like a real challenge for him. And Frank was just kind of watching him trying to figure it out and smiling. And Frank said, you want me to come up there and play it?
Nice.
And Tommy says, come on, Frank, be serious. I'm trying to work this out. Because, Tommy figured, well, if he's having this much trouble, there's no way in hell Frank, as a guitar player, can play this. So Frank came up, and he just whipped it right out. But the thing was, when he wrote it, he conceived it as a two-handed piece. When he showed Tommy how he arranged his hands over the keyboard and worked it out with the two hands, it was simple. It was kindergarten simple.
Nice.
But trying to do it with one hand was just virtually impossible. But, as a keyboard player, you look at this passage in one restricted area of pitches and you figure, okay, well, it's one restricted area. I'm going to do it with one hand. But if you actually use two hands and stack them one over the other and, assign certain notes to the left hand, certain notes to the right, it became ridiculously easy and sounded fabulously incredible because it was just – it sounded way, way, way more difficult than it was if you actually did the fingering the way Frank conceived it. So that was a very interesting aspect of it, too.
Would you think that we were talking a second ago about different styles of music from around the world? Do you think or could you relate what Frank did, which was always a little different, but was it based on any other culture's music, would you think, or something that's similar?
I wouldn't really say any other culture. I would say it was an amazingly eclectic mix of various, basically American styles of music. Everything from jazz to doo-wop to classical and modern new music classical. Heavy metal rock, and that was another good thing, a cool thing about it too. We had to be able to play all of those things with total authenticity and change on a dime from one to the next, depending on whatever hand signal he might give us. where something that was at the moment heavy metal would turn into Mr. Rogers style, and then go into reggae, and then go into country, and we had to do all that. But yeah, as far as other cultures, no, I really wouldn't say that. I would say it was just an amazing amalgam of a broad cross section of lots of American music.
Right. Yeah, I remember Ed was telling me that I didn't know if everything, I mean, absolutely everything was written out note for note. And he went, you know, no, as far as what instrument to play, had a lot of freedom going, well, I'll try, you know, xylophone on this and, you know, whatever. Did you guys all have that kind of freedom to be like, here's what I want you to play, but let's choose, you know, you can choose kind of what sound you want or what instrument, or, you know, did you have a lot of freedom on that?
Well, it was a case by case basis, but it was again. Frank was very open to all kinds of possibilities, and he would have a suggestion, and if that didn't work, he would know it right away, and if he had another idea, he would suggest that, or if he didn't, he'd say, "What do you think? Or what sound do you think it ought to be?" So that was a fun aspect of it as well, and a perfect example of the kind of sonic palette and his approach to this whole thing. Unlike a lot of other situations where you were as a basically quote unquote side man, you were kind of under the thumb of the primary artist, and they tried to they would use whatever you could do to enhance their show and what they wanted to present. But you were, pretty restricted in a lot of the situations that I worked in.
Mm-hmm.
But with Frank, it was exactly the opposite. He would put you, instead of under the thumb, he would put you under the microscope and find out every possible sound you could create in any way, whether it was a mouth noise, a body noise, an instrument of any kind. And he would figure out a way to use that to his advantage and make interesting, wonderful music with it. Perfect example, we were in Zurich, Switzerland on the 82 tour, and I always liked to get up early and go out and explore because these were places I'd never been before, so
sure.
It was fascinating to me. And so I went out and I found this little shop where this little old man made Alphorns, the big long wooden horns.
Oh, yeah, of course.
The Ricola,
right, sure, yeah.
Yeah. And I bought two of those and brought them back to the hotel. And the longer one of the two was so long that the tiny hotel room could not contain it. And
wow.
So I hung the end of it out the little balcony and was playing it. And I wasn't aware of it at the time, but Frank was outside downstairs having lunch at the outdoor cafe. And he heard this and realized pretty quickly that it was me. And told me, bring those. I want them in the show tonight.
Of course.
And so the Alphorns were in the show that night, and me and Tommy Morris did sort of a trade back and forth with this wonderful sort of French horn kind of sound he would create on one of his analog Moog synths.
Right.
And that was a perfect example of Frank's spontaneity and wanting to just use everything his musicians could possibly do. He was very much into exploring the capabilities of all these, wildly innovative musicians that he worked with over the years.
Now, you guys, a lot of times they had samples of dogs barking and just all kinds of stuff. Who was in control of those samples?
That would vary. On the 88 tour, he brought his SynClav out. That was the first tour that he really brought the SynClavier out. And that was a time when sampling technology was really had really come a long way.
Right.
And sometimes he would actually trigger the SynClavier, but we also had it set up so that I could trigger it sometimes. I think, as I recall, Ed could even trigger it from some MIDI controllers that he had as well. And there was another that reminds me of a really funny, one of my funniest Zappa memories was on the 88 tour, We sort of did some jazz spoof things. In fact, one of the records, one of the double CDs from that tour is called Make a Jazz Noise Here.
Right, sure.
And we used to kind of goof on the sounds that some jazz musicians tend to make when they're playing.
Yeah.
These funny grunts and groans and things. And so Walt Fowler recorded some sounds into Ed's sampling gear. And Ed would then trigger them with a MIDI controlled pad.
Right.
And at one point he got the idea, hey, I can pitch shift these things with a pedal controller.
Right.
And so he took one of we're running out of time.
No,
he took one of these sounds. He took one of these sounds and that Walt had made and pitch shifted it right while Frank was in the middle of drinking some coffee.
Oh boy!
And Frank just totally broke up with wild laughter and spewed coffee out his nose and all over the place. It was just hilarious. The sound that Ed made with the sample was hilarious, and Frank's response was like classic.
You hear him all the time. I bought this thing. Remember this thing? Can you hear that? I bought this.
Yes. Yeah.
That weird tube thing. You guys, they used it a lot, and I picked it up at a gas station and went, hey, there's that weird instrument thing.
Right. You swing it around, and the air column. Depending on how fast you swing it, you can shift it into from the fundamental of the first harmonic to the second harmonic.
I don't even know what you call it, but I like it, and you can buy it for a dollar, and they're loads of fun.
Right.
We are running out of time here. Robert Martin, ladies and gentlemen, this is fantastic. I could make a 4-hour interview with this.
Man, I could too. I could too. It's great fun.
Well, actually, I'll probably have to do another one just because I'm gonna, now that I'm on a roll, I've got more questions. But
Give me a holler when you're ready.
I certainly will.
And there we go. My little chance to talk with Robert Bobby Martin about Frank stuff and things, and what a guy's cool. I really like him. I've never gotten a chance to meet him. Maybe I will if I fly out to Los Angeles and see what he's got going on. These guys are fun when I meet up with them. It's pretty interesting. They're all just people. Isn't that weird? They're all just people. You know, you listen to the records and you go, wow, these guys are just like magic people that don't exist in the real world. Well, they do. So let's see. TonyTrombo.com, TonyTrombo. Please subscribe to my YouTube channel here. That really, really helped. I'm in the process of posting a ton of these Talking Zappa and other shows up here on YouTube. And subscribe so you'll know when they pop up, because they're always interesting. So I'll see you next time on the world-famous Talking Zappa. Hey, everybody, it's Tony Trombo. Today's show is brought to you by Audible.com. Now, you can get a free audiobook. That is a free audiobook download and a 30-day free trial at audibletrial.com/Tony Trombo. They have over 150,000 titles to choose from for your iPhone, Android, Kindle, or MP3 player. That's audibletrial.com/Tony Trombo.
Good night, Austin, Texas, wherever you are.